This talk is about how infrastructural problems look as seen from a parallel field. I will be describing a specific problem as well as available solutions, and then focus our attention on a specific solution to a problem. And the problem I have chosen is, I chose it essentially because as the program, I am here in the framework of the Big Sky Earth collaboration. Essentially, the story is trying to find commonalities and lines of common interest in between astro and geoinformatics. And of course, there are many things that differentiate, that separate us, that differentiate the things we can do. And I think this is one of the central ones most of the times. The most important point, the key point in modeling in geoinformatics is related to the idea that proximity in space and time is strongly connected to logical to the existence of logical relationships in between the random variables in your model. It's, let's say, the fundamental idea in essentially everything that we do. And the point is that this spatiotemporal proximity is most of the time not given in astronomy, simply because distances are so vast, and because, well, as you will see, we tend to work in the image space a lot, and of course that would mean nothing typically in astronomy, as per the case of the MISA stars.
Okay. I hope that's better. There is a specific motivation for this. And the specific motivation is the need for global scale near real-time analysis. The European Space Agency, in particular, is, well, 2 points, essentially. The European Space Agency organizes up camps where people are invited to jumpstart development of applications that run on global coverages based on advanced algorithms. Furthermore, there is this tendency towards interactive data exploration of global coverages, global multi-temporal coverages at very high resolutions. This means that, let's say, very complex algorithms need to be efficiently deployed on very large data quantities. And, of course, this entails, this is part of a crisis, really. Remote sensing archive sizes are growing. In Europe, this is because of the Sentinels. There is a growing palette of competencies needed in order to get to the point of being able to deploy these global scale applications. And let's say this is just one slide giving you an example of one of the sensors we are speaking about, a essentially Europe is launching a 30 satellites constellation with sensors that range from radar to multispectral and resolutions from decametric to metric, which means essentially petabytes now. And the first satellite was launched in 2013, and zettabytes very, very soon. And what do we want to do with this kind of data? We want to be able to run interactive image analysis at global scales, while the reality is that full image product based access is the standard access method. There is essentially no API based access for, let's say, that has touched more than 200 users, probably 300 perhaps, in the world of remote sensing. Essentially, in order to be able to run your analysis, and you typically have a very well specified area of interest, you do download, you query the archive, you get back IDs for image products, you download the image products of interest. Each one has a volume that ranges from 1 gigabytes to 7 gigabytes, let's say. So you download it, and then you concentrate your analysis on the area of interest. There are, of course, a couple of very nascent alternatives, very early stage alternatives. But, let's say, the standard method still is full image product access. How would, then, a system for interactive mining in Earth observation, for scalable and interactive Earth observation mining, look like? Well, that depends a lot, of course, on the kind of pipelines, of analytical pipelines that one intends deploying on such an infrastructure. A typical pipeline looks like this. We want to generate thematic maps, which means map of land cover classes or land cover change classes, starting from a raster dataset. What we do is essentially we extract primitive content descriptors from the data. We learn a supervised classifier from a series of examples. We classify the data, and perhaps we can, well, and we definitely validate the result. while standard infrastructures, and I mean you download the data to your laptops, are adequate for limited data volumes, in the case of global coverages, and this is 25 centimeter resolution data, so you really see the people on the beach. In order to be able to scale this to global scales, what you do is, of course, you divide and conquer. You essentially tile your data and run the analysis as far as possible in parallel on the different tiles. Now, the interesting point with respect to this talk comes when not all tiles have equal value. And you take into account things like real-time interaction and the cost for this analysis. The idea is that the idea is you have a list. You can, of course, split it in two and process the two sublists in parallel. But the point is, you are really interested in the last elements in the list. Shouldn't you be rescheduling reorganizing the list, so the lists so that the elements of interest come early in, let's say, the mapping in the parallel processing. There are standard solutions to that, batch parallel processing, and let's say different kinds of data processing architectures for big data. All of this leads in, let's say, standard architectures for remote sensing. Essentially, image products are acquired, they are processed based on standard pipelines, and they are sometimes annotated by specific application domain experts. Of course, this is an extremely expensive, time-consuming, subjective, and necessarily incomplete default procedure. And then some user queries this data, and is able to process the data. Now, if we are to be able to run analysis at global scales in this kind of architecture, of course, the first possibility is to organize some parallel batch mode processing architecture. Essentially, input data residing in an historical archive gets divided into pieces. The pieces are processed perfectly well in parallel. The results are collected and queries are run on the collected results. There is a problem though, and the problem is that lots of data arriving at the input batch of data repository. The standard solution to that, since 2011, is to run the analysis into two parallel lanes. A batch one for large, slow, frozen historical data in batch mode again, and a streaming data line for smaller, fast, and light data. The two lines produce results that are equivalent, essentially, that need to be fused together at the collector before queries can happen. Now, this has clear advantages. You get the best of both worlds. You get to analyze historical data efficiently and streaming data efficiently. But, of course, it has significant costs, because essentially you need two systems that only merge at the end to be able to run these analyses. An alternative is, of course, to try and use streaming data analysis for historical data as well. Essentially, use stream processing for everything. You will have a way to stream historical data from the historical frozen archive into a live stream that is seen as just another real-time stream by the stream processing system. And essentially, an obvious addition to this is to add a scheduler, so that essentially you have an agent that is smart enough to traverse your historical archive in a way that makes sense in semantic terms, perhaps, or in terms of, let's say, the consumption of this data. The agent traversing the archive will be spitting data, will be outputting data to the stream processing system. And essentially, then the hard problem becomes how to put how to insert intelligence in smart schedulers for optimally iterating historical data elements presenting their best streams. Now, the kind of update that you need in STAN web, in the existing big data analytics pipelines for geospatial data is straightforward, essentially. Data are typically composed in global coverages. Well, typically. There is only a couple of systems that operate and essentially only one that is stable and operational right now. But both organize image products into global coverages, operating a multi-resolution tiling. And the tiles are processed in parallel. The results are cached in a repository and served to user interfaces. Now, what you need to do is, of course, to add to this a scheduler, essentially, that controls the consumption, well, that controls the data that gets sent to the processor that is not anymore a standard parallel processor, but rather a streaming processor. Now, here we get back to the first law of geography. Since proximity is important, you want your scheduler to be operating based on locality. And the typical way to do that would be to employ space filling curves. And this is, of course, not at all a new idea. Inbound curves, for instance, have been used for scheduling parallel processing already. And of course, they are widely used in organizing geographic maps. And so the idea is really to exploit user interests, well, the locality in user interests, in geographic spaces, in the space defined by multi-resolution pyramids, and possibly in space of semantics. What you get in the example before, if you essentially go through tiling and then extraction of content descriptors, and then in the training of a classifier, and then in a classification of the generated tiles in a streaming processor, is essentially that you go from populating the results in a way that is not dependent on the original structure of the data and is not randomic, but rather aggregates, well, populates first the results around points of interest. And of course, the processing costs stay lower than in all other cases. And that's really it, in the sense that, let's say, this is not a solution for every problem, definitely. Yet it tries to unify processing for light and historical data based on a certain paradigm. And essentially tries to do that in order to address issues and opportunities that are relevant for research as well as for the educational and the market views of what we do. that is accomplishing, let's say, this kind of global scale interactive analysis, augmenting the impact of infrastructures that right now, in most cases, tend to be completely image-based, image product-based, and disconnected, let's say, from what is happening with internet-based mapping services, and so on.